Good morning. Good to see you here. There's our Seaside Band, sounding as wonderful as ever. Thank you guys for always being here on Sunday mornings. Thank you. I have a few invitations for you, but before I begin, I want to just take a moment to introduce the practitioner that's holding the light for us today, Practitioner David Hackett. Thank you, David. We have a wonderful group of practitioners here at Seaside. We got together Friday evening for a recommitment ceremony for all of our practitioners. It was such a beautiful experience to all be together in a sacred ritual. And we're going to know a little bit more about that today as they recommit. But just a reminder that our practitioners are always available for prayer. It is their joy and their honor to pray with you and for you. There's a few ways you can receive prayer. You can go out the side doors after service to the area which we call our prayer chapel. And you can hook up with a practitioner there, and they will take you for a one-on-one private prayer. You can write a prayer request and put it in the prayer request chest behind where David is sitting or out by the prayer chapel. And those are taken and gathered up confidentially and distributed to all of our practitioners where your prayer will be prayed for several weeks. So, and we also have online prayer too. You can go online and submit your prayer online. So lots of ways to receive prayer here at Seaside from one of our practitioners. So today is our back-to-school Sunday, if you will. We've got lots of back-to-school events going on. Our Seaside education is starting. Our children are having a back-to-school event. We've got lots of fun things going on. So let me just tell you a little bit about that. Today we have the wellness group with Dr. Christina Tillotson, and we have a beautiful guest, Dr. Jane Cohen, who's a transformational counselor, and she is going to be here right after service at 12:30 in the Emerson Room. She is going to be giving an hour and a half presentation for absolutely no charge, and you will go away with an actual tool that you can use in your relationships and transformation. So please be there and be part of that if that's something that calls to you. It's open to everybody. Our children today are having a wonderful back-to-school kind of a fun celebration in the park after service. So our youth and family ministry is going to be in the park. They're having food and treats and games and, most importantly, ice cream sodas. So that's going to be happening in the park after service. We have our Seaside education that is starting. So in your program, you should have an education catalog. I want to tell you about just a couple of the classes. The class that you want to take very first, if you're new to Science of Mind or if you haven't taken any of our certificated classes, is the Foundations of Science of Mind. That's with Dr. Christian on Tuesday evenings. It starts this Tuesday in 2 days, 6:30 to 9:30, right here in the sanctuary. Arrive a little bit early to do your registration. Sign up in the family room today, so we have workbook for you. It's a wonderful opportunity to dive into the principles of Science of Mind, to learn affirmative prayer, to be in a space with Dr. Christian where he can get to know you and you can get to know him in a more intimate setting. So I encourage you to take that class if you have not taken it. If you've already taken it, then the next class is Dr. Christina Tillotson's Essential Earnest Homes. That is also on Tuesday evenings. It's at the same time, 6:30 to 9:30 in the Emerson Room. Sign up in the family room for that today as well. We are offering, which we don't always, a daytime option. We're offering a daytime foundations class with Reverend Lori Mack, who's in Rome today. So she's not with us today. She's traveling into Italy with her honey. But you can sign up for her class. It won't be starting till the first week of October, but please sign up today. We'd love to know that you're going to be there. It is required to have 6 people minimum for that class to go, and I think we've already got 3. So jump on in if a daytime class is what works for you. Also, we have a wonderful class that's being offered through our Seaside Sisters Women's Ministry. This is a special offering from Callie Holmes Sorensen, Dr. Christian's beautiful wife, who is the head of our Seaside Sisters Ministry. She is doing a workshop called The Heart to Lead, and it is a beautiful female empowerment workshop. It's a way, it's a very heart-centered experience. I was fortunate enough to experience it. I went to one of the Montana retreats that she held, and it's a beautiful opportunity for all of you women to step into your power with an open heart. So sign up at the Seaside Sisters table today or see Callie after service. She can tell you more about it. It's Thursday evenings. That will be on Thursday evenings. Reverend Lori Mack, as I said, is out of town. So this Wednesday evening, we have Reverend Lori Sheets, who will be speaking. She'll be speaking Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and her topic is acceptance and the peace it brings. So that'll be Wednesday night at 7. Last but not least, I want to just mention a little bit about our bookstore. We have a fantastic bookstore. If you haven't been in it, I encourage you to go in and check it out. We've brought in lots of new items. We're having a minister's conference the last week of September, so we're getting all ready and beautified, and we've got lots of great things. We also just brought in the Sounds True line of books and CDs and audiobooks, so I encourage you to go check it out. It's lots of leading edge books that we're able to keep up current, what's happening. We've got books that are Soul Sunday books, Oprah Soul Sunday, and some really new current things, so I encourage you to check it out. I did bring in some guided meditation tapes, which several of you have asked for, so they're in there as well. So check us out in the bookstore afterwards, and we would love to have you join our bookstore team. We're looking for a few more volunteers to help support the bookstore. The commitment is one Sunday every 4 to 6 weeks, so it's not too much, and we'd love to have you be part of our team and come play with us. So see me or Nancy Cunningham after service if you're interested in being in the bookstore and being part of that group. With that, I'll just ask you to stand and greet your neighbor, and please remain standing for the congregational song.
Song. All right, this is a brand new one, brand new, so I hope you like it. So, 1, 2, 3. I want you to just think of the words of the song. I know you don't know it, so I'm going to sing it for you and then sing along as you learn.
I'm held in love. I'm held in peace. God is holding me. With every breath, with every step, God is holding me.
Let's do that again.
I'm held in love. I'm held in peace. God is holding me. With every breath, with every step, God is holding me.
Session goes.
God is holding me. God is holding me. God is holding me. God is holding me.
Very nice, Seaside. Come on, Bob.
That
again.
I'm held in love. I'm held in peace. God is holding me. With every breath, with every step, God is holding me.
Holding me, oh yeah,
God is holding me. loving me.
Yeah, Seaside. Very nice.
Thank you, Rebecca. Hey, good morning, Seaside. Oh, what a joy it is to be with you. On a wonderful day, what a great affirmation. God is holding me. If anything is going on in your world that is less than wonderful, if you could just remember to say that or sing that to yourself, because what they say, singing is like praying twice. So, you know, God is holding me. And just get that. Things will just transform. Ease and peace return. That's great. Thanks. Wonderful new song. Thank you, Rebecca. Hey, so here we are in moving through summer, just truly blessed, and how wonderful it is to be sharing a Sunday morning with you. And if you're here for the first time, welcome, welcome, welcome. Your presence makes a difference in the Sunday morning. And just know that Seaside is a wonderful community, a place where it is non-judgmental, it is caring, it is kind, it is love. We're here to support each other on our spiritual path, and with whatever it is we're going through, it becomes our classroom, our laboratory, our soul processes. And so to move us into a deeper connection with that wonderful place of divine realization as a powerful practitioner, and that is Ellen Rice.
Good morning, everyone. As we move into this time of consciousness, just make yourself comfortable in your chair. Close your eyes if you wish, and join me in the stillness. As I recognize the divine spirit is in this very room, I know that God is that one mind within me, within everyone and everything. And I know God is the abundance and the health, the intelligence, the love and the happiness of planet Earth. I know each person here receives this love. And I know that as we listen to Reverend Christian's message today, that we are blessed.
God is so good. God is so good.
Thank you, Rebecca Jade, so beautifully reminding us that God is within us. And practitioner Ellen Rice for praying us in so beautifully. Thank you so much. Good morning. I'm Reverend Christina Tillis, and it's my honor to again welcome you. If you're new to Seaside Center for Spiritual Living, we're so blessed that you're sharing your light with us here this morning. And we have a special gift for you. As you go out the back, there's a packet that has all kinds of goodies and a coupon for the bookstore and a CD from Dr. Christian to show you how much we appreciate you being here today. And especially on a day like today, because, of course, you know this is the 15th anniversary of 9/11, and it's such a blessing for me to know that I'm part of a spiritual community that is part of a worldwide organization called Centers for Spiritual Living in Golden, Colorado, whose vision is to awaken humanity to its spiritual magnificence for a world that works for everyone. And so on a day like today, it's so precious to me to be reminded of that. So thank you for being here to remind us of that. And here at Seaside, we have lots of ways to awaken you to your spiritual magnificence. Right after this service at 12:30, as Reverend Deb said, we have a wonderful workshop presenter, Dr. Jane Cohen, who will allow you to find your center when you have relationship issues and conflicts. And I am so blessed because here at Seaside, we teach the certificated classes from Centers for Spiritual Living that are truly designed to awaken you to your spiritual magnificence for a world that works for everyone. And of course, there's Dr. Christian's foundation class, but if you've taken his class, and I want to extend a personal invitation to you to the class that I teach, which is called The Essential Ernest Holmes. It's a very, very profound class that goes into the writings of our founder, Dr. Ernest Holmes, and allows you to synthesize those principles into your own life to allow you to ignite your life. And I wish it were called Ignite Your Life and Transform the World with the wisdom of Dr. Ernest Holmes, because that's what it truly does. And this is the only class I teach at Seaside every year. I'm the distance education dean for Centers for Spiritual Living and the Holmes Institute. So I don't have time to teach classes except for this particular one. And the reason I teach this one is because it's so profound. So please sign up and come on Tuesday night, and it'd be great to see you. We also have a testimonial from an amazing person. Her name is Amanda Worth, and she is a combat veteran. She wanted to be here today, but she's a professional violinist, and she got called to Florida to play for a military event. And so here's Amanda.
I'm here. I'm really excited about that, and also excited to share my enthusiasm for the programs that Seaside provides. Specifically, I can speak to the Foundations class. I'm a speaker. I have a pretty great career. I have a great life, and I get stuck. Everybody gets stuck. And spiritually, I just felt that I was drying out, and I was dealing with pretty severe headaches. I was unsure where my relationship was going. I had recently relocated, and I just felt like something was missing. And I learned about the Foundations class. I was brand new to Seaside, but the truth always has a funny way of finding you if you're receptive to that. And I knew there's something there for me. And hey, it's a couple of Tuesday nights. What do I have to lose? And in that experience, I gained so much more than I could have fathomed. Reverend Christian was an incredible teacher, not only speaking about the philosophy and the history of science of mind, but also providing practical tools, practical tips. How do I apply spirituality to my life? Because spirituality is life, and I want to be connected to that. So I discovered that, you know, life wasn't the problem. I was really the problem. My thinking wasn't really aligned with what I wanted, and I wasn't really being honest about what I wanted. And so throughout this course of intimate conversations with a unique cornucopia of a variety of people from the community, you know, I came to know the truth about not only science of mind, but about myself and how to change the way I speak, change the way I think, show up in a better way for myself, a better way for the world, so I can experience joy, you know, the opposite of unstuck.
Yay, Amanda. I have to give a testimonial for one of my students. She just emailed me this week, and the ending project for the Essential Earnest class, she started writing a children's book for kids from 3 to 7 about spiritual principles and science. It's going to be published before Christmas. And I got to write the blurb for it, so I'm very excited about that. So it all starts Tuesday night here at Seaside. Be here. So let's take these ideas into prayer. So going to that place within where I know there's only that one power, that one presence, that one life, that one energy that I call God, can be called Allah, it can be called the Force, it can be called Adonai, it can be called the Tao. Whatever it is, it's that power and that presence that is throughout all of its creation, from the tiniest atom to the farthest galaxy. It is all one, it is all life, it is all love, it is all God. And that is who I am. And each one here is, and with the sound of my voice, is a perfect expression of that light and that love and that peace that passes all understanding of spirit in human form right here and right now. And so I'm knowing for this sacred time together on this anniversary of 9/11 that out of this sacred time together, all fear, all anger is transcended. That the truth of this world, this light and this love of spirit is revealed through and as each one here. And that truth is revealed as each one here and flows out into this community, into this country, into this world, allowing that any appearances of fear to be transcended and replaced with that light and that love and that perfection of spirit, because within any challenge, there is spirit, and that's all that matters. And so I just gratefully accept this knowledge of that spirit of light and love and peace within all and with everything and with every situation as I release this word to the law, knowing that it's now done in perfect peace and grace and love. And so it is. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning, Seaside. It is my honor to introduce our guest artists every Sunday, and today it's me. Reverend Christian is always so kind, and he's like, you bring in wonderful artists, and he said, but every once in a while, it's okay. We love having you. So I wanted to take the opportunity to be here and share a couple of special songs with you today. Before I start my song, I wanted to also mention that this weekend it's coming up, the concert with Sheila E. afterward, and so that's coming up this weekend. I'm so excited, and thank you for those of you that got tickets. And I wanted to mention that it is outdoors, and it's so make sure to bring chairs, blankets, all that stuff. No outside food, but they'll have all that stuff available. So, and also, I forgot to mention this in the first service, but I'm going to bring out I send out emails every once in a while, so if anybody wants to be on my email blast, I'll be sure to put out a list so you can just put your name. And I send out stuff just to let you guys know what's going on. Released a 48-hour film project that I was part of a couple weeks ago. So I have a bunch of little things kind of happening. And this song I want to do for you is actually a brand new tune. I've only done it maybe once, one other time, but I'm recording it in the studio right now. I'm going to release it as a single very soon. And I love this song, and I hope you love it too, because it's just a positive message. And of course, also with it being the anniversary of 9/11, it's all about perseverance. I really believe that in all facets of life. So I hope you like this song. It's called What's It Gonna Be?
To recognize your power when all the world seems to be bringing you down. You want to hide behind the comforts of a lie to ease the pain of not believing you deserve the crown. In the sun, no, don't let no one win your race. No, no, you've only just begun. Listen. what's it gonna be? You might lose or you might win, as long as you stand strong to the very end. Oh, what's it gonna be? Life has a way of seeming impossible. Keep holding on. Nothing today can keep you from a better tomorrow, unless you let it. Don't let it. Come on. What's it gonna be? You might lose or you might win, as long as you stand strong to the very end. Oh, what's it gonna be? See it through. Do it for you. Just do it for you, yeah, yeah. You can fight or you can hide, run away or take it in stride, yeah. What's it gonna be? You might lose or you might win, as long as you stand strong to the very end. Oh, what's it gonna be?
Rebecca Jade. Woo! All right.
Thank you, guys.
We see that song racing up the charts. Say we heard it here first at Seaside.
Thank you, guys.
Rebecca
Thank
Jade. Woo! All right, Rebecca. Oh, wow. Yeah, that's good. Standing strong. What a great message for this. Obviously, today is September 11th, and 15 years ago, I would say many of us in this room could say where we were, you know, what it was we were doing when we saw what took place. And what took place changed the way our generation operates in this world with a sense of ease and comfort and grace. And I can remember growing up, I could never understand why my dad could always remember Pearl Harbor Day. You know, December 7th, it was a day I had to memorize for a test question in my book in class. And I didn't get it. And after September 11th, I got it. You know, I understood that things were never quite the same after that. And I mean, symbolically, you know, the Twin Towers can represent inside of us, you know, those two pillars or those two towers that are within us, the good and the not so good, you know, the Mother Teresa, the Saddam Hussein, you know, the light, the darkness. And, you know, which one of those towers is going to rise from the ashes? Which one of those are you going to feed? Which one of those are you going to listen to and begin to see take form again in your life? You know, it comes down to your choice on what you're going to do with what took place, because things happen in our life that just may not feel right. But you know what? If they happen, what's going on? But what happened that day is that a new meme was cast, a new vibration. And I've had people say, "And what's a meme?" The America vibration, that new level of being. It's like at one point when people thought the earth was flat, and then when they realized the earth was round, It was no longer flat. There was a new meme. There was a new consciousness. There was a new awareness that was established. Well, on that day, what happened is all of a sudden, our country was beginning to be dictated by fear. That all of a sudden, decisions were based upon fear and protection and attack and defense. And we began to have to live with this heaviness that sat there because the tower we chose to honor began to look like that. Though what happened on that day was an amazing thing, if you remember how the world's heart opened up to us. All of a sudden, we had our enemies reaching out and saying, America, just sorry, we love you, oh my goodness, how could that have happened there? But something happened. We went in a different direction with that, and that's what happened. And because of the fear that we were fed and they kept putting our face, we made choices. We choose to have given up some of our freedoms, some of our independence, our privacy. We're willing to give up our privacy and have stored our records, whether it's the phone or our web searches. You know, we're willing, you know, with TSA, you know, before then you used to be able to get to the plane at the last minute, no problem, you get in. It's not like that anymore. You know, and I'm not saying one is right or wrong. What I'm saying is that we were given a choice between these two towers as to what it is we were going to do with what was there. And we have lived under the onus of that fear and that terror for so long. And it's time for us to be able to work on forgiveness and to letting go and to moving forward with our life into that new kind of freedom, that new kind of self-expression. Yes. But as I work within my own heart and soul, what I kind of recognize is it's not as much for me having to forgive what took place on September 11th, 15 years ago. Oprah Winfrey, one thing she said is forgiveness is your ability to be able to say thank you for the experience, which I thought was pretty good. But I'm not able necessarily to move beyond that experience because there is so much inside of me that is still, I don't know if angry is the right word, but to see our children be sent off to war and to come back just damaged, I don't know if damage is the right word, but they come back without their innocence any longer. They come back with the memories and the terror and the conflicts. All of a sudden, we are living under the heaviness of this. And so inside of me, there is this continuous working. You know, forgiveness is what can, you know, patch up the holes from the storms in consciousness. But when you're filled with the anger, it is a virus within your mind that takes away your peace. It is a virus that is continuously operating. The only way to eliminate it is with patience and forgiveness. And the forgiveness doesn't always make a lot of intellectual sense. The mind doesn't, hey, how can I forgive such a horrendous, heinous act? But you know what? It is about the heart and the soul that wants to be able to live with its freedom and its privacy and its expression and the soul expression without the kind of fear and concern of being able to stand up here and say something and all of a sudden, without due cause, be incarcerated. But you know, times have changed. But what is happening is, what is it that we're feeding? Remember that, not remember, it's still fairly new. All of you probably heard it. It comes from the first people, the Native American nation of a kid who was all upset and angry and because of the alteration that he had. And he was talking to his grandfather. You remember this story? And the grandfather said, hey, you know, calm down. I've been there too with the anger and the pain. And he said, how'd you do it, Grandpa? He said, well, it's like two wolves inside of me. Remember this one? Yep. One is, the wolf is angry and revengeful and hateful and just malicious and just nasty stuff. And the other one is love. It's caring. It's forgiveness. It's understanding. It's kindness. And the kid thought about it and said, and so which one wins? And the grandpa said, that's right. Whichever one you feed, right? Things happen, and there is anger and new ways of being. But which one do you feed? Which one in your life, in particular issues? There was this another kid with the anger issues going on. And this morning's message isn't really about anger or forgiveness. I'm really going to try to get to a place of no separation as God's everywhere, even in the midst of September 11th. But It's everywhere because all of us were. But this one kid has got the anger issues, and he went to find this teacher who was sitting in the woods against a tree, you know, near the lake, beautiful spot. And he said, "Hey, my name's Ben. I'm just unhappy with life. I am miserable. I am angry. I'm not enjoying it." And he said, "Whoa, whoa, calm down." The kid said, "But can you help me? Nobody's been able to help me." And that teacher thought about it and said, "I'll tell you what, just go grab, you know, a cup of water out of the lake for me." So the kid brings back this cup of water in a couple of minutes, and the guy, he reaches into his satchel or his bag, and he pulls out a handful of salt, and he throws it in the water, and he kind of stirs it up and said, "Here, take a drink." The kid takes a sip and goes, "Oh, that's terrible. You know, it tastes like salt. Yuck." And the guy just laughs. You know, it's kind of funny. So he gets up, and he walks down to the lake, and he takes a handful of salt again from his bag, and he throws it into the lake, and he watches it dissolve, and he pulls out his glass, he scoops up some water, and said, "Here, now drink." And the kid drinks and goes, "Wow, that tastes good." And he said, "I'll tell you what, your anger is like that salt. You know, the salt always tastes the same, but it's dependent on how strong it is as to what it's in. And I recommend that you work on expanding and not be the cup, but to be the lake." Hello. You know, it's like, where are you taking your issues, your anger, your resentment, that stuff that got you wrong? Are you holding it inside of your mind and trying to heal it right here in this little space? Or am I going to drop it into that lake of the God consciousness? Am I going to drop it into that infinite level of possibilities that far exceeds my intellectual understanding because it makes no sense to forgive this situation? Am I going to move beyond, okay, this took place, I'm going to just stick it right here and I'm just going to leave it? Right? That's compartmentalizing. Spirituality is moving beyond the compartmentalization because God is in and through all things. It is everywhere, which means that what I need to do is be willing to move into those darker recesses, be willing to look at that anger issues, be willing to look at the upset, be willing to look at that new vibration or that frequency that is being fed in my life through my behavior and realize that I need to drop this behavior into something bigger than I am. I've got to be willing to take a look at, you know what, this enlightenment that Marshall was asking me about. It's like, I sat with that enlightenment. What's enlightenment, Christian? That was a good one to throw at me last week, you know. But enlightenment and wholeness is to be able to live without an anxiety towards those things that are different than you. Those things that seem to be not perfect. Those things that I don't understand, can I sit there without an anxiousness and open up to the diversity of the possibility of what is being offered to me through this experience? Because we are living in a diverse country. We are blessed. And how many of the gifts are you open to, are you able to receive from various ways in which you didn't know? I got to tell you, I didn't really realize that this week was the beginning of Hispanic History Month. I won't ask you if you knew that. But, you know, the Latinos are a very influential part of our culture. And here's a wonderful short minute and a half video from one of our Centers for Spiritual Living that is trying to inform, working on bringing this awareness and information, you know, to us about the gifts. About American history.
Hi, I'm Vivian Perez, a member of Center for Spiritual Awareness, West Sacramento, California. Welcome to Did You Know American History? In this video, we will educate, celebrate, and share historical information about Latino Americans who made a difference and that have influenced how we live, work, and play in our everyday lives. The term Hispanic or Latino refers to Dominican, Puerto Rican, South or Central American, or other Spanish culture or origin, regardless of race. Today, 55 million people of the American population are of Hispanic or Latino origin. Hispanic Heritage Month begins each year on September 15th, the anniversary of independence of five Latin American countries: Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua. Celebrations continue with many countries around the world celebrating their independence throughout the 30 days. Originally launched as Hispanic Heritage Week under President Lyndon Johnson in 1968, in 1988 it was expanded by President Ronald Reagan and enacted into law. Every American president, Democrat and Republican, has issued proclamations endorsing the theme. Hispanics have had a profound and positive influence on our country through their strong commitment to family, faith, hard work, and service. They have enhanced and shaped our national character with century-old traditions that reflect the multi-ethnic and multicultural customs of their community.
So am I able to be open to receive the gifts that are there, that are around us? You know, this video reminded me of the time I was part of the Association for Global New Thought, and we created the Peace Train that was doing these whistle stops from L.A. up to Sacramento, and it was for the beginning of the Gandhi, King, and Chavez season for nonviolence. And it was interesting. I found myself sitting next to Dolores Huerta, and I didn't know who she was. It was like, not until she got up on the stage, well, before then, but it came to me, here is the individual who's the co-founder of the United Farm Workers, co-founder with Cesar Chavez, who we're celebrating this whole thing. I'm sitting next to the equal of the creation, and I didn't even know that. And it just opened my eyes to the realization that there are so many blessings and gifts around us. And, you know, in the Latino, we probably all can tell this great clothes designer from Puerto Rico who's designed clothes for all the first ladies for years and years, right? Oscar de la Renta, you know, the influence in our world. But and do you realize we have our first Latino person, individual, sitting on the Supreme Court right now? That's right. You got that? Sonia Samir. It's like, all of a sudden, are we able to open up and say, you know what? I am no longer afraid of what it is I don't know. I'm no longer afraid to go into the darkness and the tower of the wolf that is going to rise within my consciousness is now open to the gifts that are available. Because as I begin to drop my mind that says, look at this difference and look at that difference, I begin to recognize, look at this similarity, look at that similarity, and it's God that is residing at the heart and the soul of all people and the religions. You know, Christianity, in the mystical part, talks about surrendering to God, where the Hindus and the Taoists talk about merging with the true self beyond one's identity. The Buddhists talk about the emptiness and no self. But you know, if you get rid of like the words or the dogmas or the creeds, they're all talking about going into that void. They're talking about going into that space where it all comes from. It's all spirit. You know, we all come from that place and we all return to that place, right? We all come from the void and return to the void. We all come from the nothingness and we return to the nothingness. You know, we come into this world, we do a little dance and you know, like the waves rising out of the ocean. And then they go back into the ocean. You know, what it matters is your expression while you're here. It's not, you know, the form and what it is, you know, that I am able to hoard and hold on to. I mean, you know, it's like things come and they go. Like, where did this week go? I mean, it's like, vroom. The week, where'd this year go? Yeah, it's like, hello. Well, yeah, this year been fast for you? It has for me. Or I'll tell you what happened to the 90s? Yeah, they're gone. Or the 19th century, or the Roman Empire, or the Greeks, or the pharaohs. What I want us to get, it's how you are being when things happen that anger you because you're a human being, that you have been stepped on or done wrong, but there's something inside of you that said, I am not going to feed the retribution. I am going to be one who brings a benefit to the wholeness of this world. I'm not going to be one who perpetuates the inhumanity to man or to other human beings because I don't understand or I am anxious or I'm now living in fear. But you know what? I'm going to feel that presence of God. I'm going to go beyond the initial feeding from the media or the headlines on this is how I'm supposed to be, because to understand the true reality, you've got to look beyond the net of your own thoughts and impressions and desires, because that net is made up of the inner and the outer, the right, the wrong. And to be able to see that true reality, one has to step beyond it. And it's not hard. It's a net. It's filled with holes, for heaven's sake. You know, you got to be willing to let go of your position or your desire, because we get at a very young age, we learned to defend our possessions and our positions. And what's we're professing, what we profess, what we possess, and any other P's I could come up with in this moment. We learned at a young age. Mar, if you want to show this slide, you've probably seen this week or last couple weeks. So today, in church, a guy in a dress tries to drown me. And I kid you not, my family just stood there taking pictures. Yeah. But it's deep, too, you know? It's like, gosh, this is how I see it, and this is the way it is. And what we get to do is live in the equity of the equilibrium of our consciousness. So if I believe that the world's out to get me, then what I'm going to live in is a world that is out to get me because God is in and through all things and is manifesting at the level of my belief. If I believe that the world is filled with love and caring and compassion and that whatever took place is moving us to the next level, then the world I'm going to live in is going to be filled with love, caring, and compassion and moving us to that next level of loving, the ability to see my brothers and sisters and the unique gifts that they are bringing. If I believe in a world that is filled with clients, I'm going to have a world filled with clients. If I believe in a world of scarcity and not enough, then I'm going to be experiencing the constriction and the difficulty of that consciousness because the world responds, life responds. Neville Goddard, he a wonderful contemporary of Ernest Holmes, he said, when you can believe in your assumptions, then you can sit back and watch the world perform. It is. There is an honest response to where you're really at. But how honest are you in the world where you walk? Well, yeah, I'm pretty honest. There's not pretty honest, you know? You're honest or you're not. Well, you know, it's pretty clear. No, I mean, it's, you're either honest or you're not. And there's this wonderful question you can work with your children. Ask yourself, too. But can your honesty stand up to public scrutiny? And I can remember the question that was asked as a child, a conversation that was created by the story of 20 monks and one nun were sitting in the teaching room for their retreat or their extended time to learn from the master teacher. And even though the nun's hair was shaven and her clothes were plain, it was pretty clear that she was, you know, quite attractive. And many of the guys fell in love with her, which is absolute taboo. No, you just don't do that in monasteries. And, you know, one guy actually wrote her this love note, kind of anonymous, and she didn't respond to it. But the next day, after the master teacher did the teachings, she stood up in the group and said that I received this love letter. If you really love me, would you stand and embrace me now? So what would you do? How honest are you in the midst of public scrutiny? That's right. Are you able to stand up and show your love when it's not cool? Are you able to stand up and speak your truth when the people are filled with anger and revenge and hate and let's attack and get even? Are you able to stand and say, you know what, there's a spiritual principle here called peace and love that needs to prevail. And you know what? I sure don't feel it going on inside of me. But what I know through my spiritual teachings and trainings and meditations is kindness matters. Caring is what needs to be expressed. Understanding needs to be expressed here. And I need to be honest and standing in this when everybody else is ready to take up the big guns and do the attack and say, you can't do this to me anymore. You know, all of a sudden, am I able to stand in that place of knowing that even though the situation is looking one way, because this is how it's been fed to me to be seen, that doesn't mean it is the only way. There is this twin tower of possibilities, and which one am I going to feed inside of myself? Am I going to go with the light, or am I going to go with the destruction? The choice comes down to you, because we're living in a world where there is enough. You know, we're living in a world where there are answers. We're living in a world right now where I've read or I understand our grain elevators and silos, there's enough, you know, grains to feed the hungry of this world. my understanding is that there is enough power now with the renewable energy and the water with desalinization, and there are millions that are dying of sicknesses where the cures are sitting on the shelf. And so this world, it doesn't need more food, more oil. What it needs is more love, more caring, less greed, greater compassion, and a willingness for individuals to stand up honestly and speak the truth and say, which wolf are you feeding? Which tower is going to rise in your life? You are the one who gets to decide. We've got going on right now, or last month when I was in Montana, I spoke, and a couple girls from the congregation, Montana, said, hey, we're going up to North Dakota. They're doing the pipeline's trying to go through the property there, and we need to take a stance. We need some help. You know, anybody can join us up there. And I hadn't even heard of anything at that point. And all of a sudden, it began to gain momentum. But it didn't really get news at first. All you got were up there on this Indian nation, there's more nations that are showing up. There are more tribes that are showing up. And now dogs are biting people, and there's pepper spray. Remember, that's what we knew about the conflict that was going on there. It was only recently that there was a shift in the consciousness and realized that more nations of our first people or showed up and raised their flags in solidarity than ever and said, you know what? You have taken and taken and taken from us for 500 years. Please not again. And all of a sudden, the pipeline, the ones with the funding, the ones who can do battle in the courts, all of a sudden say, no, no, no. We are going, they're desecrating the sacred grounds, the burial grounds, and we are going to run the pipeline under the Missouri River. You know, remember this last year when there was the oil spill in Yellowstone National Park and it was horrendous? Or the year before in Montana where the rivers were destroyed and the fish are still dead. They're saying, you can't do this to us anymore. And the people say, yes, we do. We have the order. But what had happened is there is a new meme. There is a new consciousness that is standing with Standing Rock Sioux Nation and saying, you know what? We have got to care more about our water and our environment and the people than we do about the oil and the money that can be exploited from this land. It's got to stop. And because of this collective push, it pushed beyond the five or six controlling corporations of the media to the people's voice was heard, and our nation is now standing up. And this week in the courts, they said, put a stop to it until we evaluate it to a different place. And as a result, the chief said, you know what we do? We're about peace and prayer here. Thousands of the indigenous people lined up along the pipeline, sat down and just did prayer and said, you know what? Prayer and peace will prevail here. That this will be a resounding testimony to a nonviolent approach to expressing what is right here. It's not sending toxic fracked oil underneath our rivers and across four states, but it's the people saying, you know what? It's time for this to stop. This is ours. This is ours, not those who can pay the most for it, but it's all of ours to enjoy the fresh air, the climate, and the good that is here. Because we are living in a world where there is already enough of the grains and the foods and the oils and things like that. But what are we going to do with it? And I get that it is it can create controversy, but I'll tell you what. It's time for us to not be confused or mistakenly confused that taking a principled stand is an issue for social justice and human justice, and that it's not a political position. Don't be mistaken to think that the principled stand for an issue of justice and human dignity is a political issue. It's not. It's not. Though it will be tied at the hips by the media and the politicians to move groups of voters. But human dignity, human rights, is not a political issue. It is a spiritual issue where we get to stand and say, you know what? What's right here? How is spirit to express here? Am I willing to stand in the confrontation of what is going on against the big boys with the big guns and come up and say, what I'm going to feed here is peace. What I'm going to feed here is a truth. And I get it's scary. I don't want to sound flippant. I get that it is scary to stand up when the confusion of the tension of positions shows up in the family dynamics or at work or with friends. But, you know, you have the other option of doing nothing, which I'm sad to say I've seen too many ministers not because they don't want to offend. They don't want to sound too political. But I'll tell you what, there is no option in my heart and soul that I must stop and step into messy situations and speak what it seems to be that truth that supports the human dignity and the human rights of individuals, and recognize that, you know what, it's going to be uncomfortable to take on the bullies, to take on the isms of this world and say this is the way it is. But I'll tell you what, then you end up with bigger things trying to get your attention, like bringing down towers that say, hey, pay attention. There's a greater something that needs to be understood here, because hatred is not the natural state of the human being. It is love, it is caring, it is compassion, and it is essential that we begin to take a look at what is driving me. James Thurber, American cartoonist, said, hey, you should have a desire before you die to find out what you're running from, you're running to, and why. Because I'll tell you what, it's all going to lead you back to the void. It's going to lead you back to that emptiness. It's going to lead you back to spirit and recognize that that spirit is the essence from which we all come, that we all are, that it is our brothers and sisters in our neighborhood, in our nation, and upon this planet. And we're all going to return someday to that collective ocean of consciousness, which is spirit. But in the meantime, we're moving through this world, and can I stay conscious of my connection with the infinite presence of God and come from a place of love and come from a place of compassion, come from a place of caring, and let go of the judgments and let go of the fear? And when something inside me is triggered, am I brave enough to go into it and take a look at those dark recesses of my being and saying, what is going on there? Because I don't want to compartmentalize and say, just don't go there and just don't deal with it, just don't talk about it. No, I want to be open, because the presence of God is everywhere, and I've got to be willing to talk about and explore every aspect of my being, because God is there in the most horrific and scariest moments. But the more I come to recognize the light in all aspects of my life, I have so much more to bring to the world. And so I want to end with one last reading. It's kind of a poem. It's from September. It's about September 11th of 2001. It was written by Stacy Randall. I don't know if it's famous or not. It's the first I've seen it, but it got me thinking. It's about a minute and a half, so relax. You say you will never forget where you were when you heard the news on September 11th of 2001. Neither will I. I was on the 110th floor in a smoke-filled room with a man who called his wife to say goodbye. I held his finger steady as he dialed. I gave him the peace to say, honey, I'm not going to make it, but it's okay. I'm ready to go. I was with his wife when he called as she fed breakfast to their children, and I held her up as she tried to understand his words, as she realized he really wasn't coming home that night. I was in the stairwell of the 23rd floor when a woman cried out to me for help for the very first time in her life. I've been knocking on that door of her heart for 50 years, I said. Of course, I'll show you the way home. Only believe in me now. I was at the base of the building with the priest ministering to the injured and the devastated souls. And I took him home to tend to his flock in heaven. He heard my voice and answered. I was on all four of those planes in every seat, every prayer. I was with the crew as they were overtaken. I was in every heart of the believers there, comforting and assuring them that their faith has saved them. I was in Texas, Kansas, London. I was everywhere. I was standing next to you when you heard the terrible news. Did you sense me? I want you to know that I saw every face. And I knew every name, though not all know me. Some met me for the first time on the 86th floor. Some sought me with the very last breath. Some couldn't hear me calling to them through the smoke and the flames. Come to me. This way, take my hand. Some had never heard my voice before, and few chose for the final time to ignore me. But I was there. I did not place you in the tower that day, and you may not know why, but I do. However, if you were there in that explosive moment in time, would you have reached for me? September 11th, 2001 was not the end of a journey for you. But someday, your journey will end, and I will be there for you as well. So seek me now, while I may be found. Then, at any moment, you will know you are all ready to go, and I will be in the stairwell of your final moments. Remember, I love you, God. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, let's keep it going as we bring Rebecca back to our stage.
All right. Well, that's incredible. So to kind of match up Reverend Christian's message, I wanted to do a song I think we all know. And, you know, one part is in honor of Gene Wilder, who just passed away. And he did an amazing song from a fantastically fun movie. And but the message in that song is much more powerful than the film itself, I think, personally. And it also just touches on what Reverend Christian's message was about just seeing the good, seeing through, seeing what you want to see, the light in people and just your imagination, you know? It can be reality, I believe. So this song is called Pure Imagination. Hope you like it. Come with me and you'll be in a world of pure imagination. Take a look and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin, traveling in the world of my creation. What we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world? There's nothing to it. There is no life I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. Thank you.
softly look around and view it. Anything you want to do it. Want to change the world? There's nothing to it. There is no life I know to compare with pure imagination living there. You'll be free if you truly
Hey. Our Seaside Band. Thank you so much.
That is Rebecca Jane. Truly beautiful. Woo. That is wonderful. You know, that song, I think I've told you guys this. I, you know, I came out of Hollywood when I was a kid. I used to go on do acting gigs, and it was Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, the original one. It was either that kid or me. I had been doing all the screen tests, and I still can remember my lines run, I found the golden ticket, I found the golden ticket. And so whenever I hear something like that, it conjures up, I wonder where I would have been if I was this kid star. And so I'm sure right here with you in this moment. There's nowhere else I would rather be, that's for sure. Anyway, it's a joy to be able to come to this moment and just say this is a time of our service where we share our gifts, we share our offerings, our love, and our support that helps create a community that teaches us, you know what? What we get to do is bring forth the spiritual perspective in all situations. Like, it helps us to find the courage to stand and realize that we are each spiritual leaders that are called to speak a spiritual truth or a new thought in the place of the fear, or the anger, or the confusion. That, you know, it's not something that's coming from outside. It's coming from inside of us. And we create a community that empowers us to know the truth of who we are. We're not victims and not knee-jerk reaction to what's happening in life, but rather that I am able to feed that inside of me that knows that God is in and through all things and see that and feel that. It's a community that has the courage to stand in messy times and remind us of the truth that is. So with that, I invite you to listen to your heart to give from that place. I want to invite our ushers to come forward at this time and say thank you to you. Thank you to those that mail in your contributions when you cannot be here on Sunday. Thank you to those that participate with the auto tithe, that regular systematic support from your world into Seasides. Thank you to those at home that participate in your givingness. We know you're there. We feel your support. It is appreciated. And I share this prayer of gratitude with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a blessed moment where the divine unfolds its expression as our very life, allowing each of us to be that wonderful vortex of the divine flow that lifts us ever higher in ways in our world that are right and real, whether it's in a monetary way or whether it's with a health issue or whether it is with our living environment. What I know right now that God shows up in our lives in those areas that are relevant and real and dynamic as we continue to remember to be in that flow, that this flow is what lifts us up above the confusion and the concern to the light and the realization. So I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to be in a place where the blessings of spirit are, and the ability to share those blessings, knowing that it goes forth into life, bringing greater good to everyone it touches. I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, for the responsiveness in ways that are real within my life. And so it is. Amen. Together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. Those are your guys from Seaside. Great job over there. And so I stand before this bounty, and I can feel the outpouring of love, for truly this is a statement of love and support of Spirit's work. And I know right now that those have chosen to give this day, this year, in their life, continue to be in service of that wonderful vortex of the divine flow. There is a wonderful reverberation. There is a healing. There is that wonderful equilibrium of wholeness that expresses within one's life, the equivalent of one's consciousness finds expression. And I know that this that has been given in love, it is handled in good stewardship, and is put forth back into life, bringing the blessings, being that energy, being that spirit in motion, bringing the gifts to all that comes in contact. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity. And so it is. Amen. This is Richard Drutman. He is one of your board members here at Seaside, and your Dodgers are looking pretty good. May our Padres be looking as good. But I don't do public prayers for that. Though it is the first day of the season. Rebecca, you're fabulous. You're wonderful. Bless your heart. Thank you for sharing your gifts. Looking forward to your songs being up there. Looking forward to seeing you Saturday night. Dr. Christina, always a joy to share a Sunday with you. And I know Jane is going to be back in the room with your wisdom keepers and for your wellness group. So, hey, Steve, today, thank you for the sound. Appreciate that. Marv, for the visuals. Know that there are CDs available right after the service if you'd like to pick one up. And Timothy, thank you for sharing this message with the world. What's going on here makes a difference. It allows individuals to know that there are options, and that which we feed is what makes a difference. So those of you at home, we know you are there, and we're grateful for the spiritual work that you're doing and standing in your willingness to share spiritual truth and principles and bringing that new thought to your friends, to your family, and just another alternative to speak about, and your guts to stand in the messiness and the discomfort of just sharing different ideas and possibilities. You are making a difference, and we appreciate you. Flowers today. One of our mama practitioners here at Seaside, Jan Hartman, is off taking a sabbatical. She'll be back next year, and so she has sent these flowers today in honor of our practitioners, because once a year what we do is our practitioners recommit to service. They started off in the classes like the foundations. We're telling you this week, sign up, become part of, go on into Christina's class and other classes. But these individuals have put in a minimum of 5 years of work before they could become licensed or at least sit for licensing. And then they have since committed their lives to daily practicing the spiritual principles. They are licensed by the organization every couple of years, but every year they recommit to Seaside, to God, to all of us, to be a conduit for spirit to move to this movement. And Friday night, they did that here in community, and we do it publicly here for all to see. And so what I want to do is invite all of our religious science practitioners to come stand up here on stage as we go through this recommittal service that we every year at this time we do. It's wonderful for me because the beginning of September is my anniversary of being here, and today it marks 25 years since I've been part of things. And so for me, this is part of my commitment with this group. to be able to share this and to feel this. And so I want us to recognize that this is a very holy moment. It is a moment in which these individuals are willing to stand publicly before us all and recommit to being used by the presence of God. And so it's through their rededication and their vows that they're about to take in a voluntary way that they offer themselves once again to God, to life, to that divine presence, to be used to help lift humanity and consciousness to a new level and to a new realization of a possibility when what is put before them is a position of confusion or that which is less than wholeness. And so you have elected to join those that have gone before you since the 30s that have stood in this moment and say, I am committed to this organization. I am committed to God. I'm committed to being a conduit through which that spirit moves into form. I'm willing to sit before individuals who are caught up in their pain, whether it has to do with the body, whether it has to do with the soul, or whether it has to do with the spirit, and say that there's a new possibility, there's a greater possibility, and I am choosing to feed that divine presence that lies within you and to call that forth for all to see in its glory once again. And so I challenge you not to fall prey to the evidence of form, remembering that you are greater than any physical fact, or that God is greater than any physical fact, that the old ways of a seeing don't require effort. That's what is fed to you by the authorities, by the professionals, by the standard way of believing. But one moment, and that divine realization, everything can shift, and the new tower emerges, the one where the presence of God brings the option of peace and love and caring and compassion, consideration, kindness, where the judgment dissolves, where the anger is gone, and you realize that you are coming from the wholeness, the void, the emptiness that all the great philosophies have talked about. And in our high-tech, quantifiable society we live in, our heads want an explanation for everything as to how this is possible, but the mind can't measure or grasp the power that you are working with. It can only see the results and feel the splendor when you have chosen to merge with that wholeness once again. So I charge you to continue your daily spiritual practices. For when people present to you evidence of this world, that you're not fooled into believing that that is the spiritual truth. That in the midst of the grand confusion and the storms of life, you remain a radiant pillar of light and life and love, a calming presence. And you will hear the voice of God sounding as your intuition, a stirring in your soul. I challenge you to be a pioneer in this new spiritual frontier rather than just be a settler and rest on those that have gone before you, but an experiencer of the presence itself. So I ask you, do you so consecrate yourself as a practitioner of religious science, working under the authority and the license granted to you by the Centers of Spiritual Living, that you will rely upon and adhere to the principles taught by this movement and practice it in the art of its science of spiritual mind healing? And will you be ever aware of your high office and function and conduct yourselves with a dignity, with an integrity, with a moderation and a sincere devotion in every act and in conformity with the code of ethics of a religious science practitioner, knowing your deeds impact the practitioners of this whole movement? And do you dedicate yourself to whoever may call upon you in a time of need? And will you be so consciously aware of the divine within all people, no matter what the outward diverse expression may be, seeing only the perfection of that spiritual person that is perfect, whole in body, mind, and soul?
Yes.
And finally, as a practitioner of religious science, do you bind yourself to absolute secrecy because it's sacred, keeping inviolate the confidence and identity of those who come to you for help unless you receive their explicit consent to do otherwise?
Yes.
And so we acknowledge you for your dedication, for your life to continuously be one who is practicing the presence of God. We honor you. We do, don't we? Yes. You can say it with me. We honor you for your commitment. Together. And committing yourself and to your spiritual growth, to committing yourself to. We acknowledge you for knowing peace. Harmony. And divine right action in the midst of confusion. We honor you for taking a bold stand. For the divine and for the new thought. Where there is pain and misperception. And knowing the ever presence of God. We thank you for dedicating your life and your service to Spirit and doing that in front of us and being the spiritual foundation of the Seaside Center for Spiritual Living, which is all of us. We love you. We honor you. Thank you. So I'll tell you what, while you're standing, sorry to cut off your applause, but a quick prayer, and just knowing that this is a blessed moment in which we have just witnessed that divine commitment of individuals to be that conduit for that God expression. They stand as an example of what is possible, an exemplary example of individuals who are committed to seeing the truth in the midst of pain, in the midst of confusion, in the midst of anger, in the midst of a broken down body, to recognize that with the presence of God, there's a new way to see and a new way to be, to feed the God that is possible in all dynamics. We stand this day in peace with an open heart, believing in the good that is prevailing upon our planet that each of us gets to play. And if there's any spot in our life that is experiencing the resistance, the constriction, or the disbelief, allow it to dissolve into the nothingness and choose to feed it no longer and to believe in the love and the caring and the compassion of brothers and sisters around this planet as companions and bringing forth the greater possibility of this world in which we live. That the diverse expression of God shows up through a diversity of individuals and cultures and ways of being. And so I choose to open my heart to understand in new ways, to see as God sees beyond the net of my desires and my plans, and stop defending my position and my possessions and what it is I profess, and open up to what God professes and what God delivers and what Spirit brings in this moment in life, for this world is in need of your spiritual leadership. And I know for each and every one that is part of this community, a new strength, a willingness to stand in the messiness and the discomfort and the confusion, and to be that conduit which brings heaven to earth. I say thank you for this ability, and knowing that healing happens with it. As Spirit flows, there goes God in all its form and all its glory. So I say thank you, thank you, thank you, not to anyone or anything. It's just in this gratitude I let go, and I just allow Spirit to have its way in this moment and receive the wonderful, glorious expression of that good as life's experienced now. And so it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged, struggling just to make it through another day, you've got to let it go. What you have to say. Come on, Seaside. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here.
And her affirmation is, I understand beyond my comfort level. Oh, that's a good one to say it. I understand beyond my comfort level. Touch your heart like you want it to be so. I understand beyond my comfort level. One more time. I understand beyond my comfort level. And our song of grace.
God's grace shines on me, and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We're living in love. We're living in peace. United we stand as one family. Together we walk. God's grace moves through me, and it moves through us all. We are living.